appropriate kickoff. Actually, I have to give Louisa credit for this, that we would start by taking a selfie. So come on, ladies, and you're going to be our backdrop. So if you could just sort of, ready? All right, we're going to post this and give it to the DMEXCO team. I have to do it because I'm the longest arms. Okay, ready? Okay, can you guys in the background wave to us? Please make it look good. To get Heidi, hold on. Yay! All right, we got it. Okay, thank you. All right. So I'm going to sit in the middle. Yeah, okay. So it's interesting, right, because we were having our prep before we came down. And I've done this panel now for 3 years. The first year I participated. Last year I moderated. And this year I have the joy of moderating again. And we were discussing sort of some cultural things, right? So the first year I did it, we had a moderator, was a gentleman who's a good friend of mine now. And talking about gender in the workplace and gender in general isn't necessarily something that is sort of as front and center in Europe, specifically in Deutschland, as it is in the US. And we were also discussing the fact that despite Louisa being based in the UK, we are kindred spirits. Not only because we're women in tech, we're women in a similar industry, but we all have on great shoes today, which is also part of it. So, you know, what I want to sort of talk about is that our industry, and these ladies are going to introduce themselves in a second, but the thematic of today is that our industry over the last kind of 3-4 years has really migrated from a language and a business of marketing and marketing communications, which is very much a pink industry, yeah? Women quite often participate in marketing, they're front and center, the CMO roundtable had two women you just saw, to one of media, which is a little bit more sort of math, science driven, et cetera. And then lastly, we're the point of arrival. If you walk the show floor or you look at any press today, we are now in an industry of technology. And quite often women get left behind there for various reasons once the language changes. So these women are exceptions to that standard. So I'm gonna start with my left and let Heidi introduce herself.
Sure. My name is Heidi Messer. I started in the internet in 1996, co-founding a company called Linkshare, which invented what's now known as affiliate marketing. We sold the company in 2005 to Rakuten for a little under $500 million. And then now I'm on to my next venture, which is called Collective Eye, short for Collective Intelligence, focused on big data and analytics.
So I'm going to ask as Shelley, because she just said $500 million. Did you guys hear that? That's the point at which if you're at a Jay-Z concert, he drops the mic and walks off stage for any of you that like American hip hop. So I'm going to ask that when the beautiful ladies to my right talk about their business accomplishment as well, they use numbers because they're all incredibly impressive, the extent to which they've been accomplished. So Shelley.
I'm Shelley Zalis, and I actually am one of the pioneers of online research. So when you get those really horrible long surveys online, I have a little bit to do with that. I started a company called OTX, grew it over 9 years, and sold it about 4 years ago to Ipsos, one of the largest research companies in the world. And I'm really just so proud to be sitting here as a woman, but more importantly, you know, I always say, oh, don't hire a woman, hire me, because I think women bring so much amazing talent to the table that really complements a lot of the skills that our male partners have.
I'm Louisa Wong, and I'm the Global Chief Commercial Officer for Amnet. It's the trading desk of Dentsu Aegis Network. I'm very proud to be part of the founding team, which is made up of a lady called Ashwini Karandika, the president, and myself. We started the business 3 years ago, and we're now in 24 countries with 450 employees. We've worked hard, yes. Lots of blood, sweat, and tears, lots of, to your point about having to speak a different language, but we're very proud of the business that we've built today.
Okay. So we had the good fortune of chatting a few minutes before the panel, so I'm actually just going to continue the conversation that we started. I'd love to lead it off with Shelley, I believe, had asked Louisa the question as to how she got Amnet to where it is, right? Her partner is Ashwini, who's also a woman, was originally going to be on the panel. We're blessed to have Louisa in her place. So can we just tell us that story again as to why you think you guys have gotten done what you've gotten accomplished over the last couple of years?
Yeah, I think, you know, we're both very competitive, which is always very lovely. But I think the language that women use speaking to each other, we're very collaborative, we're very open. I don't think, you know, we shout at each other necessarily, like possibly some men do maybe. And we work things out and we know when to take a step back and take a breather and say, how do we approach the problems that we need to solve? But also, we're also very practical. You know, we think about things very systematically. Even the way we launched the business consistently across all the 24 markets, there was a calculated methodology. And it was that patience, that hunger, and that desire to win that helped us build the successful business that it is today.
Yeah. So Heidi, I would love to ask you, you know, you founded a company, you exited it, an incredible accomplishment, and now you've started a new company, you know, you've done it all, now you're taking a chairman role. Talk to me about the sort of contrast and the ebb and flow between your leadership style versus your management style, how you build a team versus how you lead a team, and how that plays into what you've accomplished.
Well, first of all, I'll start off by saying I think women are any company's secret weapon. And I'm not going to make too gross a generalization, but the women that I've had the privilege of working with tend to have been overlooked at other companies and come with this drive to excel and really push themselves. So I think just to give a shout out to women in terms of bringing them in part of management teams, I think all of us here would attribute our success to, you know, the women that we had behind our backs as much as, you know, any of our own individual efforts. In terms of leadership and management style, you know, we were talking about this before the panel. The internet is an incredibly female-friendly environment. You know, it's economically driven almost entirely by women. 80% of the purchases that are made on the internet are done by women. It's a very collaborative environment. And again, these are gross generalizations. There are certainly men who are capable of these skills as well, but it's one that women excel in. And I think the key thing for me when I look at it in the leadership and management style is how do I take all of those advantages and make it a place where I'm looking purely at skills and purely at talent and not being jaded by stereotypes or preconceived notions.
Yeah. So Shelley, you've built an incredible business and you're now sort of carrying the torch in a different way, right? I mean, how has from where you've come in that journey gotten you to where you are? And what, when you look back in hindsight, I have this great book that I have in my nightstand that is Letters to Ourselves, Women's Like Madeline Albright, Olympia Dukakis. It's letters they would write to themselves, you know, 20 years ago. What would your letter say?
Wow. You know, I think the most important thing for me today is leading with generosity. And I grew up in a culture where no one gave me anything. I had to find my own voice. I had to earn my keep. I had to obviously lean in, but more importantly, I had to stand out. And I think that, you know, what I believe in today is how do we transform our corporate cultures from a culture of rigidity to a culture of generosity? And how do we create the right corporate culture that we could, you know, really enforce more work-life integration, or as I say, work-life styling, because I'm not really sure what balance is. We shouldn't work to live. We shouldn't live to work. It's a dimension of who we are. And I think oftentimes, you know, we fall into this gender issue. I don't think it's a gender issue. I actually think it's a caregiver issue. And, you know, as we rise the ranks, because we start as 50-50, gender balanced, as we're starting work. It's as we rise the ranks, women opt out. And women opt out because our roles at home increase, our responsibilities with our elderly increase, and so we can't do it all. And caregivers are predominantly women, so it becomes a female issue. And so I really do believe in giving back as a leader. I don't think we lead to lead. I think we lead with inspiration and inspire a whole new way of moving forward. And change will only happen if we activate those changes and believe that we're in position to do that.
Right.
So I think it is our responsibility.
So I want to make sure we manage expectations about, this is about smarter technology, right? So I think one of the thematics that I think would organically attach to is how do you bring a team of all genders, how do you bring them along for that journey? As organizations are being redefined, as talent skill sets and talent pools need to be reshaped and reestablished, job descriptions are radically changing and being added net new. You know, how do we bring them folks along for the ride, young women, young men, et cetera? I mean, Louisa, you know, and so just to give sort of a landscape here, Louisa's driving automation and sort of the technology side of it. I mean, Shelley is really driving sort of a, you know, this research rigor and precision with analytics-driven business. And then Heidi's really built this platform that is this amass and this fire hose of data. How do you actually make it actionable and create business value from it? Like, this is the bread and butter of our industry right now, right? So I would love from each of you to hear how you create, if you're focused on driving the business because you're all running a business, how do you make sure that there's a runway behind you to allow others to fill those shoes? So I'll just open it to you guys.
So I'll start. I'm very, very fortunate to be part of a group, so Dentsu Aegis Network, where there is a framework to exactly do that, to nurture the talent, to develop talent along the way. So we have frameworks like what we call Route 500, and it's anybody from an entry-level graduate planner right through to, you know, a CEO of a market, and there are tools and there are platforms in which we use to enable them to learn and share from each other, shepherd each other, but more importantly also, you know, the opportunities possibly to even move to other markets and other countries to experience new cultures. So I'm very fortunate I have that as a platform, as a group. And then I'm also very fortunate to be part of a community, an advertising community of friends in the UK, and actually because of my global role all over the world, where I'm able to share ideas and to talk about how do we get the youth today into the industry, because they're going to have to learn new skill sets, right? They're going to have to learn a new language. So what opportunities can we bring so that we're at the forefront of this? So not a teenagers leaning back saying, I don't know what this advertising thing is, but being more proactive with them and giving them the tools and the platform to share their ideas too.
Do you find that what's coming out of the pipes right now as far as sort of new recruits, new graduates, right? Because that's like media, the business we're in, we like pull them from the womb of higher education and then we start hammering them, right? And that's sort of how you move up the ranks typically within advertising. Do you find that this current generation is equipped, or is there a lot of, I mean, Shelley, is there a lot of sort of nurturing and molding, or is it just about giving them, you know, enough rope so they can sort of take off?
I think I'm the one being nurtured and molded, actually. I think we learn more from the digital natives and the millennials today than ever before. And I think the millennial is the new CEO because, you know, digital's in their DNA and they're living and breathing in a connected world. You know, we talk about living in Gen Z today, you know, and multitasking and multi-screening, you know, up the wazoo or on steroids, if you will. And I think, you know, just because we are seasoned and experienced in our industry for many, many years, what we are lacking is that authenticity. I mean, experiencing the screens the way, you know, the youth experience it today. So I think that we learn as much from the new kids coming in than as they are learning from, you know, the old people like us, you know, teaching them the tricks of how to engage in business today. So I think we have to open our minds and understand that they're not the ones that should be getting us coffee. They should really be, you know, sharing their thoughts and opinions, and we should be valuing, listening, and embracing that knowledge.
That's great.
You know, I was just going to say, you know, sort of tangential to that is that my whole industry, you know, Collectivized, focused on business intelligence, and when we were thinking of an acronym for what we do, BI as a service was one of the candidates, but that's obviously bias, which is the opposite of what we're trying to do. And I say that only because workforces today are probably the most challenging to manage because they are so diverse. And managing diverse companies, you know, we have people from 20 different countries, you know, different genders, different backgrounds, is much harder, but it's essential. Because to find the commonalities across multiple people who have different interests and different vantage points, that is the holy grail of the digital world. And you can only do that if you have organizations that are representative that way. Every single piece of research that has been done shows that homogeneous organizations underperform relative to diverse ones. That underestimates how difficult it is to accommodate, you know, people coming from different points of view. And particularly, I think it's probably even harder in the U.S. because there's a whole legal framework that, you know, kind of puts interests at odds. But if you don't start to see it as a business essential, then I don't think a business can succeed if it's not inclusive.
Yeah. And I think just, so again, I think relevance is critical in knowing your audience. I mean, having now, you know, DMEXCO 3 years, seen it grow and change, having lived in Europe, knowing that Europe is not a country, right? The advertising industry here is encumbered with localization, right? With different data standards and privacy practices in every country and every market. You know, whether or not you can share first-party data, what is first-party data? Is it an IP address? Is it not, right? So I think that the challenge here of having an open and welcoming organization is even more important because not only of the cultural, the language, but also just the diversity from market to market of the business practices and standards. So I think that's something to just be keep mind of.
Yeah, and I think it's just really important. I mean, I don't know who watches Who Wants to Be a Millionaire, but, you know, it's the three options. Ask a friend, and if they're not a category expert, you're not going to get the answer. 50-50, 50% chance. And then the wisdom of the crowds. Ask the audience. And that's right. I think 96% of the time, even if it's not an educated audience, it ladders up. And I think that we have to remember that in businesses today, we really do need multidisciplinary kind of skill sets brought to the table to create the kinds of products that we're living in today. And, you know, we talk a lot about technology. Technology is an enabler, but it is the different skill sets that make technology sticky. And the sticky ones are the ones that are simple, you know, easy to use, approachable, friendly, with the wrapper around it. And when you look at different skill sets, you know, when you touched upon this, Heidi, but, you know, men and women, we're all important, we're all equal, we're just different. Men in general are more strategic, more linear, more directive. Women in general are more collaborative, more visionary, and most importantly, we're storytellers. And so when you look at a lot of the technology today that became easy to use and functional and useful, a lot of it was created by women. You know, when you look at Apple, you know, and Steve Jobs, you know, he gets credit for everything, but it was a woman behind the friendly face and all the little icons that made it, you know, more user-friendly. And that's what we have to think about in our businesses when we create, you know, our skill sets and our teams. It's not gender-specific and it's not ethnography, ethnic. It's what kinds of skill sets do we bring to the table across the board that will ladder up and make magic happen. Yeah.
I think, sorry, I was just to add, I think diversity in terms of, for me, it's. I think that the diversity in Europe actually presents an opportunity. So I use myself as an example. I'm Chinese. I was born in Taiwan, but I grew up in the UK. I've lived in Singapore. You know, I've experienced different cultures. And it's because of that exposure to different cultures, not genders, that's actually afforded me to be able to work across Europe and different parts of the world. Because I looked through the lens slightly differently, because you could argue that growing up in Singapore was a very strict environment. You know, you did math, science, and that was it. You thought in ones and noughts. And then you come over to Europe, and actually you're more creative. You're taught to challenge the norm. And then you go into the US, and anything's possible, right? And I think it's embracing that sort of diversity, not just skill sets, but perspective of the world. And because we are able to be mobile these days, we can travel the world, we need to embrace that, those sort of skill sets as well, not just the what could I bring in the digital ad tech, but how could I look at it from a different perspective?
So, ladies, if we're sort of, let's take a kind of forward look now, right? If you look at your unique areas of subject matter expertise, and you're looking a trajectory of, I mean, 12 months is a lifetime in our business, right? But 12, 24 months. If you had to sort of hone in on the shortage of skills on your team and the gaps that you see from a talent perspective, gender regardless, like, where are you seeing the biggest weaknesses basically in our ability to execute and deliver to visions when it comes to building platforms, tools, data, using it, et cetera? Like, where are we weak in our within our industry?
I mean, the easiest answer for us is technology. We have issues in the U.S. with the immigration policy that needs to be changed. We have issues with the skill sets that people bring to the table and having the advanced enough skills, because when you're trying to create something that is 5 years ahead of the market, there's typically not universities that have specific training programs in it. You need really, really gifted developers to do that. And so, you know, just bringing it back again to the subject of this panel, you know, look at your company. You know, you have talent in Israel, you have talent around the world that you're seeking out. If you start eliminating 50% of the population based on gender, if you start eliminating 20% of the population based on where they're located, you start getting down to narrower and narrower pools. And I really believe that technology and talent are going to be the only two things that matter in any company. That's it.